broadcasting for a worldwide audience.
You're listening to Radio Lewes, where the music matters. Welcome to the slightly different radio show. I'm Nick Cooper, your burbling bardolator, with a show that's devoted to William Shakespeare. Yep, since, allegedly, he was born and died on the same day in April. What a busy chap he was. I thought it was time that the Bard of Avon had his own musical tribute programme. Let's start with an obvious play, Romeo and Juliet. Here's Dave Alvin. Yeah.
My darling Romeo. Well, there's a big fussy blonde in Oklahoma City, sitting in front of me trying to make herself pretty. Sticks you meet Romeo at half past three, but Romeo left town on a southbound freight. Nobody says Romeo escaped. I got something off my chest. I said, baby, what are you trying to say? She said, I hate to tell you, Dave, but Romeo is out of date. Yeah, Romeo, Romeo, wherefore art thou? Where did you go? You got all these women just a moaning low for that. Romeo, that little Romeo.
Mighty Dave Alvin with Romeo's Escape, the title track from Mr. Alvin's first solo album, which has a remarkably ugly cover. Many great artists have gravitated towards the works of William Shakespeare. One such was one of America's foremost composers, Duke Ellington. He wrote a 12-part jazz suite based on the work called Such Sweet Thunder, which is part of the captured Amazon Queen Hippolyta's speech in A Midsummer Night's Dream, in which she praises the baying of some hunting hounds. I never heard so musical a discord, Such Sweet Thunder. Curious. after that build-up, I have to confess that I don't really like Ellington Suite that much, but here's a ripping version of the title track performed by the Vienna Art Orchestra. Orchestra with such sweet thunder. Now, my strong suspicion is that, as is so often the case, folkmeister Martin Carthy was force-fed Shakespeare at school with the following result.
There was this king sitting in his garden all alone, when his brother in his ear poured a little bit of henbane, stole his brother's crown and his money and his widow. But the dead king walked and got his son and said, "Hey, listen, kiddo, I've been killed and it's your duty to take revenge on Claudius. You kill him quick and clean and tell the nation what a fraud he is." The kid says, "Right, I'll do it, but I'll have to play crafty so that no one will suspect me. I'll kid on that I'm a dafty." So with all except Horatio, and he counts him as a friend, Hamlet, that's the kid, he kids Johnny's round the bend, and because he isn't ready for obligatory killing, he tries to make the king think that he's tuppence off the shilling. Takes a rise out of Polonius treats poor Ophelia vile, tells Rosencrantz and Guildenstern Denmark's a bleeding jail. Then a group of travelling actors like 784 arrive to do a special one-night gig in Elsinore. Hamlet, Hamlet, acting balmy. Hamlet, Hamlet, loves his mommy. Hamlet, Hamlet, hesitating, wonders if the ghosts are cheat, and that is why he's waiting. So Hamlet wrote a scene for the players to enact, so Horatio and him could watch to see if Claudius cracked. Now the play was called The Mouse Trap, not the one that's running now. And sure enough, the king walks out before the final bow. So Hamlet's got the proof that Claudius gave his dad the dose, the only problem being now that Claudius knows he knows. So while Hamlet tells his mother her new husband's not a fit one, Uncle Claude puts out a contract with the English king as hitman. So when Hamlet killed Polonius, the concealed corpus delicti was the king's excuse to send him for an English hempen necktie with Rosencrantz and Guildenstern to make quite sure he got there. But Hamlet jumped the boat and put the finger straight on that pair. When Laertes heard his dad had been stabbed through the arras, he came running back to Elsinore, toot sweet hot foot from Paris, and Ophelia with her dad killed by the man she wants to marry. After saying it with flowers, she committed Harry Carry. Hamlet, Hamlet, no messing. Hamlet, Hamlet, learned his lesson. Hamlet, Hamlet, you're excused. crust, convinced him that men, good or bad, at last must come to dust. Then Laertes lost his place and was demanding retribution. The king says, keep your head and I'll provide you a solution. So he arranged a sword fight for the interested parties, with a blunted sword for Hamlet and a sharp sword for Laertes. To make double sure, the old belt and braces line, he fixed a poison sword tip and a poison cup of wine. Well, the poison sword got Hamlet, but Laertes went and muffed it, cause he got stabbed himself and he confessed before he snuffed it. Then Hamlet's mummy drank the wine, and as her face turned blue, Hamlet said, I believe the king's a baddie through and through, incestuous, murderous, damned Dane, he said to be precise, and made up for hesitating once by killing Claudius twice, because he stabbed him with the knife and forced the wine between his lips. He says the rest is silence. That was Hamlet had his chips. They fired a volley over him that shook the topmost rafter, then fought in brass knee-deep in Dane's lift, happy ever after. Hamlet, Hamlet, all that gory, Hamlet, Hamlet, end of story. Hamlet, Hamlet, I'm on my way. If you thought that was boring, you should read the bloody play.
That was Martin Carthy with Ur Hamlet, and that's not the last we'll be hearing of the doomed prince. As a confirmed bardolator, I suppose I should have been horrified by the way the film Shakespeare in Love played fast and loose with what little we know about Shakespeare and his plays, but I wasn't. Soundtrack of the hugely enjoyable and Tom Stoppard scripted film Shakespeare in Love. That was The Beginning of the Partnership, composed by Stephen Warbeck. In recent years, the Royal Shakespeare Company have been moving away from the whimsical "Hey, nonny, no" setting of Shakespeare's songs to something a little more contemporary. For a recent production of As You Like It, they employed singer-songwriter Laura Marling as lead composer.
Thank you.
Laura Marling and the boys and girls of the RSC chorus with a version of Under the Greenwood Tree. Now, having dismissed a work by Duke Ellington, I have to now confess I'm not at all keen on the operas of Giuseppe Verdi. Nevertheless, I have made an effort by including a bit of Otello, but sung by Enrico Caruso.
Agitava il petto, forse un prigioniero, era baldo sull'ivo, nulla sapevo ancor, io lo servivo sul suo corpo vivir, che mi innamoro, e si labbre mendace. Ardenti bate di Cassio, ed ora e per sempre, addio, sante memorie, addio, sublimi incanti del pensier. Addio, fiere fulgenti, addio, vittorie, dardi volanti e volanti corsier. Addio, addio, vessilla, trionfale pio, diane squillanti sul mattin. L'amore e canti di battaglia, addio, e la gloria
Enrico Caruso performing, well, sorry for my rubbish Italian, Nelle ore arcane della sua lusoria, ora è per sempre adio, which means, oh, I didn't bother to look it up, and I don't speak Italian. It is from Otello, though. I really do need to brush up my Shakespeare.
The girls today in society go for classical poetry, so to win their hearts one must quote with ease Aeschylus and Euripides. But the poet of them all, who will start 'em simply raving, is the poet people call the Bard of Stratford-on-Avon. Brush up your Shakespeare, start quoting him now. Brush up your Shakespeare, and the women you will wow.
Just declaim a few lines from Othello, and they'll think you're a hell of a fella.
If your blonde won't respond when you flatter her, tell her what Tony told Cleopatra.
If she fights when her clothes you are mussing,
what are clothes much ado about nothing? Brush up your Shakespeare, and they'll all kowtow. With the wife of the British ambassador, try a crack out of Troilus and Cressida.
If she says she won't buy it or take it, make her take it what's more as you like it.
If she says your behavior is heinous, kick her right in the Coriolanus. Brush up your Shakespeare, and they'll all kowtow. Thinkst thou, and they'll all kowtow. At Spotkins, all kowtow.
From the musical Kiss Me, Kate, which as any fool knows is based on The Taming of the Shrew, that was Jack Diamond and Harry Clark with Brush Up Your Shakespeare. No, I said brush up, not undress. Oh dear, here's The Naked Shakespeare.
The Naked Shakespeare He'd like to know what happens now. Yeah, but there are rules. What's taking place here? He knows there's absence at the prow. And it's a ship of fools. What's it take? What's it take? Boy's mistake. How will he break the chain? Learn to give and to take again. The naked Shakespeare.
That was the multi-talented Peter Blegvad with The Naked Shakespeare. Now, some Shakespeare plays are more popular as sources of inspiration. I couldn't find any music based on King John, even though it was the first Shakespeare play to be filmed. That true fact is pub quiz gold, I think you'll agree. But one of the most popular plays is, and there aren't any wild superstitions to stop me saying this, Macbeth. Take it away, John Cale.
Thank you.
from his marvellous Paris 1919 album. That was John Cale with Macbeth, and very probably backed up by Little Feat. And whilst we're with Macbeth...
Good evening. My name is Roger de Swans, and tonight, brought to you live from the stage of the Royal Stratford National Shakespeare Festival Company...
Beelzebub.
Hamlet.
Hamlet who?
Hamlet, Piglet's father. Let me in.
Oh, sorry about that. There are at least four more Shakespearean knock-knock jokes on that track by the National Lampoon magazine, but that was the best, which gives you an idea of why I played any one. Now, the next track is a long one, so you can go and order your interval drinks now. And drink them if you can get to the bar, and are prepared to pay outrageously inflated prices. I'll have a large gin and tonic, please.
A lullaby too rough. 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 I never saw the heavens so dead. I never saw the heavens so dead. I never saw a lullaby too rough.
Thank you.
That was Lullaby Exit Bear by Welsh genre-crossing jazz performer and composer Hugh Warren. It was performed by the Royal Shakespeare Theatre Orchestra, and I think it's a response to The Winter's Tale, with its notorious stage direction, Exit Pursued by Bear, which has been a source of anguish to so many theatre directors, mainly because Paddington's rarely available. When I studied The Merchant of Venice at school, my English teacher insisted on cutting out all the scenes featuring the fool, Lancelot Gobbo, because he said they were rubbish. He wasn't wrong, but that's not the only thing that's dodgy about the play.
The world was long before them. Where to choose their place of rest?
Wandering Steps, taken from Jocelyn Pook's score for the film of The Merchant of Venice, and the singer was the ethereal German countertenor Andreas Scholl. Now, a wide variety of plays have been ascribed to the pen of Shakespeare. Arden of Faversham, a Yorkshire tragedy, Edward III, the London Prodigal, but we're fairly certain of the authors of So That's the Way You Like It.
We bid you welcome to our court, fair cousin Albany, and you are sweetest Essex. Take this, my hand, and you, fair Essex, this, and with this bond we'll cry anon, and shout Jack Cock of London to the full. Approach your ears, and kindly bend your conscience to my peace. Our ruddy scouts to me this happy news have brought. The naughty English, expecting now some pregnancy in our plan, have with some haughty purpose bent Aeolus unto the service of their fair. So, even now, while we to the wanton loot do strut, is brutish bowling broke bent fair upon some fickle circumstance. Get thee to Gloucester, Essex. Do thee to Wessex, Exeter. Fair Albany to Somerset must seek his route, and Scroop to you to Westmoreland, where shall bold York, and rooted now for Lancaster, with forces of our uncle Rutland, enjoin his standard with sweet Norfolk's host. Fair Sussex, get thee to Warwicksbourne, and there with frowning purpose tell our plan to Bedford's tilted ear, that he shall press with most insensate speed, and join his warlike effort to bold Dorset's side. I, most royally, shall now to bed, to sleep off all the nonsense I've just said.
That was an extract from So That's the Way You Like It, written and performed by the quartet masquerading as Beyond the Fringe, namely Jonathan Miller, Peter Cook, Alan Bennett and Dudley Moore, comedy immortals. Sonnet number 147.
My love is seizures of fever, longing still for that which longer nurseth the disease, feeding on that which doth preserve the ill, than certain sickly appetite to please. My reason, the physician to my love, angry that his prescriptions are not kept, hath left me, and I desperate now approve. Desire is death, which physic did accept. Past cure I am, now reason is past care, and frantic mad with ever more unrest, my thoughts and my discourse as madmen's are, at random from the truth vainly expressed. For I have sworn thee fair and thought thee bright, who art as black as hell, as dark, as dark, as dark.
That was the Shakespeare heptet with a sonnet for our time, Sonnet 147. Now, 17 or so years ago, the leader of the Shakespeare heptet, Richard Gibson, decided to set all 154 of Shakespeare's sonnets to different styles of music, since each poem is about love in all its different guises. I don't know if he's finished yet, but the heptet are more than welcome to pay a return visit to Lewes. Shakespeare's work will never die, and nor, it turns out, will he.
I never much believed in reincarnation. I thought it was only people's imagination. But now I'm forced into some reconsideration. 'Cause something's happened to my cat that deserves some explanation. William Shakespeare's in my cat, my kitty is the bard. He used to be a playwright, now he's digging up the yard. He's still a cat in most respects, he likes to meow and purr, but now I introduce him as the cat that wrote Richard III. I took him to see Phantom, he said it was quite nice, but he can't go see Miss Saigon until he kills some mice.
Until he kills some mice.
William Shakespeare's in my cat, it sometimes seems so deep. Guy who wrote Twelfth Night chews on my socks while I'm asleep. I'm really quite impressed, I own the cat who wrote Macbeth. But if something's rotten in the state, it's just his fishy breath. 'Cause he wrote Romeo and Juliet, but his greatest story yet is coming back as someone's pet. Getting neutered by the vet, got his paws caught in a net. Then he said, to be or not to me. Yow! William Shakespeare's in my cat, he rarely ever talks. He makes his loudest statement standing in the litter box. He sleeps on all my shelves and throws my books about the house. It doesn't sound like prose when he bats his squeaky mouse. Sam Beckett's plays are witty, same thing for Bernard Shaw. Oscar Wilde is pretty, but none of them have paws.
None of them have paws.
William Shakespeare's in my cat, he chases bits of fluff. John Milton's in my goldfish, but I never liked his stuff. I'm thinking that Franz Kafka really came back as a bug, and I hope Andrew Lloyd Webber will stay underneath my rug. 'Cause
he wrote Romeo and Juliet. But his greatest story yet is coming back as someone's pet. And getting neutered by the vet, got his paws caught in a net. And then he said, to be or not to me. Yo!
Take it, Trevor.
Internet, and he said, to be or not to me. Yow!
Canadian comedy trio The Arrogant Worms with William Shakespeare is in My Cat. Anthony Hopkins, ooh, recent award winner, was much praised for his portrayal of Hannibal Lecter in the film Silence of the Lambs, but I thought that the great Scottish actor Brian Cox was a superior monster in the earlier film Manhunter. So I was delighted to see Mr. Cox in the seldom performed and unspeakably gory Titus Andronicus. And when they filmed Titus Andronicus, who got the title role? Anthony Hopkins. Although he was very good, and the film had a remarkable score by Elliot Goldenthal. Soundtrack of the film Titus, that was Swing Rave, composed by Elliot Goldenthal. Oh, in a fit of shudders after Titus Andronicus, I programmed another bit of film music, this time from Kenneth Branagh's Henry V.
Gloriam, non nobis Domine.
from the soundtrack of Henry V, that was Non Nobis Domine by Patrick Doyle. I think it's the bit in the film where the king dresses up as a woman in order to seduce the Dauphin. Shakespeare's plots can be quite confusing. I think I'll let Richard Thompson explain the next one.
This is the story of Hamlet, William Shakespeare's most notable play. A magnificent, dignified work of art. But to you morons, I think I better tell it this way. Hamlet was prince of a spot called Denmark. There never was such a frantic guy before or since. He was a dream boy, and like a hole in the head, Denmark needed that prince. His uncle just for marrying his mother, drove his girl to suicide, stabbed his big brother, all because he felt nobody but himself should live. He was watching my call, uncooperative. Hamlet had a girlfriend called Ophelia, a cool put together chick that made men thrill. She was from Uglyville. So he chopped off her father just to teach the girl a lesson. Cut him up in slices like a pound of delicatessen. Murder was one thing Hamlet sure did enjoy. He was watching my call, quite a mischievous boy. It was dog, eat dog, eat dog and Denmark.
Richard Thompson for promoting such nonsense at a summer solstice concert, and shame on me for not playing a proper version of Prokofiev's music for the ballet Romeo and Juliet. That was Prog Monsters, Emerson, Lake and Palmer, thundering through the Montagues and the Capulets. Now, we're nearing the end of the show, and coincidentally, it's just started to rain outside. Not really, actually, but just so I can say, oh, that reminds me of the end of Twelfth Night, and then I can play Come Away Death.
Come away, come away, death, and in sad cypress let me be laid. Fly away, fly away, breath, I am slain by a shroud of white stuck all with you. Oh, prepare it, my part of death no one is so true did share it. A flower sweet on my black coffin let there be strewn. Not a friend greet my poor corse where my bones shall be thrown. A thousand sighs to say
Ian Bostridge and Antonio Papano with a setting of Come Away Death. Now it's definitely time to drown my staff and break my books. Prospero's books. Thank you. soundtrack of Prospero's books, that was Come Unto These Yellow Sands, performed by Sarah Leonard and the Michael Nyman Band. And of course, that piece was composed by Michael Nyman. A fitting way to conclude the show. Our revels now are ended, so I shall melt into the air. You're listening to Radio Lewes, where the music matters. I'm Nick Cooper. Thank you for listening to this special Shakespearean edition of the slightly different radio show. There are so many of Shakespeare's plays that didn't get a mention, Henry VI Part 3 to name but one, but I shall remedy that with this last song, taken from the album Shakespeare and All That Jazz. Here's The Complete Works, performed by Cleo Laine and the Johnny Dankworth Orchestra. Stay safe, sane and healthy. Goodbye!
Henry the Fourth, Part One, Cymbeline. Henry the Fourth, Part Two, As You Like It. Measure for Measure, The Winter's Tale. Troilus and Cressida, A Midsummer Night's Dream. The Merchant of Venice, Richard the Second. The Taming of the Shrew. Then there's Romeo and Juliet. 30 more to do. Henry the Sixth, Part One, Pericles. Henry the Sixth, Part Two, Coriolanus. Henry the Eighth, Comedy of Errors. Timon of Athens, Julius Caesar, King Lear. The Tapestry of Night, King John and Othello. But nothing much ado. Then there's Antony and Cleopatra. Cleo to you. Henry the Sixth, Part Three, and Macbeth. Henry the Fifth, Mary of Wives of Windsor. Richard the Third, Hamlet, Prince of Denmark. Titus and Veronica, Sir Raymond the Queen. Two gentlemen of Verona, the sonnet, a Venus Adonis, a lover's complaint, the passion of Pilgrim, the phoenix, a turtle, all of them in except two that ain't. All's well that ain't well. Love's labor's lost.
Radio Lewes. Local. Community webcasting.